This is our epi curve as it is to date. About 118,000 total confirmed cases in the county, close to 6,000 over the past 7 days. And that amounts to a case rate of 87.8 cases per 100,000 people in the county. We were in the 11th just 3 weeks ago, so this represents a sevenfold increase in 3 weeks' time. And you can see that with the Omicron variant mixed in with some Delta still hanging around, we have far surpassed the peak of last winter's surge and past the peak of the summer surge we just got through with the Delta variant, with some days resulting in more than 1,000 positive tests in the county. Next slide, please. The next slide just represents the testing volume and the testing positivity rate of our county. We have completed over 1,800,000 PCR tests in the county to date, 25,000 just in the last week. And you can see how the testing percentile or positivity rate has increased tremendously and very rapidly, almost a straight line up. And currently there is a 28% testing positivity rate in the county. Next slide. So we do recognize that there is a huge demand for testing in the county and that there are some long lines at our test sites, and that because of the demand, we need to rapidly set up some new test sites or increase some hours. So I did want to let you all know that starting on Monday, just yesterday, the Ag Center parking lot is now a new test site. HR support is out there doing testing 9 to 4 p.m. The plan is that this site will have an additional lane for vaccination starting next week, possibly Monday. Currently, there are two lanes for testing. They do have PCR out there, and they will have the rapid antigen tests available until they run out. Coming soon, we have a new test site at Lodi Great Festival grounds planned for initiation next Monday. So hopefully all goes well. That is the start date, and it will be another HR support test site, which will operate Monday through Friday. In a couple of weeks' time, we do hope to have a Fulgent test group out at the San Joaquin Delta College campus, Mountain House. Just had a meeting yesterday with Lammersville Unified Superintendent and the Delta College folks. This has been approved and is now in the works. Hours are increasing at our two Optum Serve sites, one at the 19th Central Avenue site. What I've posted here are the current hours, which you would see on SJ Ready, but that will be increasing this Sunday, January 16th, to reflect that that site will now be open 7 days a week, Monday through Friday, 7 to 7, and Saturdays and Sundays, 8 to 5. The team at the San Joaquin General Hospital parking lot, which is now open 3 days a week, is also going to move to 7 days a week, and their operation will be open 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. starting this Sunday. So we are trying hard to try to increase and meet the demand. The county is also purchasing some at-home test kits to be distributed to the public through our cities and through our CBOs. Next slide, please. Just wanted to share with you on the next couple of slides a social media campaign that we worked on with RSC and ad agency, helped to create some of these designs based on our county colors and the colors matching SJ Ready's coloring. And the campaign ran towards the end of the year and really outperformed our expectations. We saw that the Latinx audience was quite attentive to these ads, 2.6 million impressions, and they were the top performer. And the highest rate of engagement with click-throughs was in the Black or African-American population. Next slide. Part of this campaign was called the Thanks to the Vaccine messaging part, and the most seen or most popular ad was this one called Enjoying Live Music Again, Thanks to the Vaccine. And just wanted to share the numbers with you so you could see the amount of engagement we've had on our social media sites with this particular campaign. And next slide. If you go to the website, SJ Bats for the Win, and this is also on SJ Ready, you could see the winners of our SJ Bats for the Win art contest amongst all K through 12 students here in the county. We had some wonderful submissions, as I said, the last time I was there, and I would really encourage you to take a look at this website when you have a chance. Lots of wonderful submissions. Next slide. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to talk about COVID-19 treatments that are available, because this has been out in the news a lot and people are asking questions about what these are and how they work. This presentation will focus on treatments available to non-hospitalized patients. So I'm not covering treatments that the hospitals offer inpatient, things that are offered as an outpatient to those who may or may not have confirmed COVID. So there are three categories here, and what you're looking at are all the medications that are currently approved and that are being allocated or distributed in our county through the state and through the federal government. So there are monoclonal antibodies, and amongst the monoclonal antibodies, there's the one called bamlanivimab, etesevimab. We call it BAM-ETI for short. There's the Regeneron medication called Regen-COV, and there's one from GlaxoSmithKline called Cetrovimab. We also have pills, and the two that have been given approvals from the FDA are Molnupiravir and Paxlovid. And then Evusheld is actually also a monoclonal antibody, but quite unique from the others, so I have separated it. It is for pre-exposure prophylaxis. Next slide. So the monoclonal antibodies, they're basically lab-made proteins, synthetic antibodies that are much like the antibodies we would make naturally as our immune system would fight off COVID. And as you see in this picture, the orange is the virus, the green would be antibodies, and the antibodies stop that spike protein from being able to bind to the receptor binding domain on your cells. And what we have found is that perhaps immune-compromised patients cannot mount a rapid antibody response when they have this infection. And even in people without immune compromise, there may be some delay with the body producing enough antibodies to really flood the spike proteins and offer the protection we need. And studies have shown that early offerings of these antibodies can help with that fight when administered early on after symptom onset. So these modes are used for the treatment of mild to moderate coronavirus disease. So basically used in people who have already tested positive for COVID and who are at high risk for progression to severe disease, including hospitalization or death. In other words, it's for positive folks who are at risk but not yet hospitalized, who do not require oxygen, or who are already on oxygen but don't require an increase in the amount of baseline oxygen they use. Next slide. So the at-risk category is defined the same for the three brands that I showed you. It is the same list of at-risk individuals we would consider using the monoclonal antibodies on. Again, mild to moderate disease, might have fever, sore throat, cough, and the like, but not requiring oxygen yet. So the list includes people who might be older, obese, pregnant, kidney disease, diabetics, immunosuppressed, they said, cardiovascular, lung disease, sickle cell, neurodevelopmental disorders, and so on and so forth. Next slide. The three brands, as I said, were Regen-COV, which is a combination of Tasevimab and Indevimab. This particular brand is used for not just treatment, but was also authorized for use for post-exposure prophylaxis. In general, all three are used for treatment for the most part. However, the top two, including BAM-ETI, can be used for post-exposure prophylaxis, meaning somebody who has been exposed to COVID, but before they demonstrate a lot of symptoms, can be utilized that way. However, priority is given for treatment purposes. Sotrovimab is only authorized for the use of treatment and not for post-exposure prophylaxis. All of them are in general given as intravenous infusions, so they do require the patient to have an IV and to sit for a few hours, whether in an infusion lab or an urgent care or an emergency department that might administer these. REGEN-COV also has authorization for subcutaneous use. Next slide. So really what I'm showing in this slide is some very interesting research about the different types. And recall the Lilly brand up in the top left corner is that BAM-EDI. And the green line represents the fact that it was quite effective against Delta virus, had high neutralization capacity. However, the red line demonstrates that this particular brand is now felt to not be effective against Omicron. With the Regeneron brand, the combination of casirivimab and indevimab, if you look at this study, you will see that it as well was effective against Delta and is not felt to be effective against Omicron. The Evusheld, which I will talk about later in the lower left-hand corner, is effective against Omicron, but very narrow and limited use for that particular drug. And then the GlaxoSmithKline sotrovimab is really the go-to monoclonal antibody now, and really a treasured item because it has efficacy against the Delta variant and the Omicron variant. However, its supply is very limited nationally, and therefore we do look to see what are our Omicron numbers right now going around in the state. As you know, nationally at the CDC level, the CDC is saying that nationally 95% of all sequenced cases of COVID are now Omicron. It has way outdone Delta and is now by far the predominant variant. In the state of California, as of last Wednesday, we were at 79% Omicron cases, and I imagine that we're over 80% now, and definitely in the southern parts of the state, we are well over 80 percentile of Omicron being the predominant variant. There are some people still here in the northernmost parts of our state that are experiencing Delta, and you will see that some of our hospitals continue to use the BAM-EDI, but not so much the BAM-EDI, more so even the Regeneron. And so as time goes on, public health will try to be informing our acute care hospitals as best we can. The recommendation is once your region goes above 80% Omicron, you really should stick with sotrovimab. But due to the limited capacity, the limited supply of this particular monoclonal antibody, you will see that physicians will have that conversation with people, and we have hospitals still using the Regen-COV. Next slide, please. Moving on to the antiviral pill, molnupiravir was the first one that came out in the news and was really heralded as a big deal, but in the end was found only have 30% efficacy. This is also referred to as the Merck pill. It was manufactured by Merck and Ridgeback Biotherapeutics, received its emergency use authorization from the FDA on the 23rd. It is four capsules that you take by mouth twice a day for 5 days. You need to start that treatment as soon as possible and within 5 days of you developing symptoms. It's offered to people 18 years and older, but not to people who are pregnant. This is an inhibitor of the virus's replication and works in a way called viral mutagenesis. So it's incorporated into the RNA of the cell, causing a catastrophic error, disrupting the virus's ability to replicate. Again, indicated for treatment, you have to have a COVID positive test. This is for people who are confirmed to have COVID, who have mild to moderate disease. But importantly, it is for those not just at high risk, but for whom alternative treatment options are not accessible. And that is because it only has that 30% relative risk reduction rate for hospitalization and deaths in their study. So this is something that the NIH says Although approved by FDA, the recommendation is to use it only if you do not have Sotrovimab, Paxlovid, or some of the other medications available to you. There was a move-in trial done with Molnupiravir with inpatients. It was found to not meet the efficacy standards required for authorization for use inpatient, but the move-out trial done on outpatients did show this mild benefit. So next slide. And the reason why there was so much news about this when it first came out was because in the beginning, in the interim analysis, there were zero deaths in the move-out group who received Molnupiravir and eight deaths out of 377 people in the placebo group. But as the study moved along, you will see at the time of full population, in the end, there was one death in the Molnupiravir group and nine in the placebo group. And you can see that there were also hospitalizations leading to that relative risk reduction of 30%. Next slide. You'll see here why in the beginning, at the interim part of this study, it was felt to reduce your risk by 50%. When you look at the left side, from 7.3 to 14.1 was the differential, but by the end of the study, it was a 3% absolute risk reduction or 30% relative risk reduction. Next slide. I will say that Molnupiravir is in better supply than this drug, which performed better. Now, Paxlovid is from Pfizer, so people will refer to this as the Pfizer drug, and it received its EUA a day before Molnupiravir on the 22nd, even though it was reviewed later. The FDA decided to approve this one, and then the next day approved Molnupiravir so that there would be two antiviral pills on the market. This particular drug is a combination of two drugs, Nirmatrelvir and Ritonavir. If you can see in the picture, you'll see that they are co-packaged together with Nirmatrelvir being the pink pills, Ritonavir being the white pills. Nirmatrelvir is a protease inhibitor, so it inhibits an enzyme that the virus needs to continue replication and reproduction. Ritonavir is a booster to Nirmatrelvir. It actually does not have the same capacity to work the way that Nirmatrelvir does, but what it does is it prolongs the longevity of Nirmatrelvir. Many drugs are marketed this way, and Ritonavir allows the Nirmatrelvir to have a sustained effect. So this is given as the three tablets twice a day for 5 days, again, as soon as possible and within 5 days of symptom onset, can be given to the pediatric population as long as they're 12 years or older and weigh at least 40 kilograms, which is about 88 pounds. Again, for the treatment of mild to moderate coronavirus disease, so those who are not hospitalized and who are positive already, who have a confirmed test and are at high risk based on the risk categories that I've shown you. This study, this drug was studied under a trial called the EPIC-HR trial, found to have an 88% risk reduction rate. Very good, however, has some significant drug-to-drug interactions, so people who are taking certain medications need to really watch out, and physicians need to know not to prescribe to those folks. It's not recommended for people with severe kidney or liver disease also. Next slide. This is the monoclonal antibody that I told you was quite unique. It's not given as an intravenous infusion. Rather, it is an intramuscular injection and very narrow use for this. It is the first therapeutic to receive an EUA for pre-exposure prophylaxis. So this is not that person who lives with somebody who's positive and has been exposed. This is somebody who has severe immune compromise and even before exposure can receive this treatment, which might last for 6 months in their system. It's a combination of two long-acting monoclonal antibodies that have very specific epitopes on the spike protein and has two uses, basically for moderate to severe immunocompromised people or for people who are not able to get the COVID-19 vaccine due to a history of severe adverse reaction to the vaccine. Next slide. As you can see, Evu Sheldon, its study called Provent, the top part of this slide is a copy of the Provent results, which showed that compared to placebo, there was a 77% relative risk reduction. They did study Evusheld in people who were symptomatic, so not just pre-exposure, but people who had symptoms, and that was called the Storm Chaser study, but only demonstrated a 33% reduction, so was not approved for use that way. And next slide. I wanted to touch a little bit about remdesivir. This is an antiviral that has been used in our hospitals for well over a year now. This is the only drug that's actually FDA approved, not just an EUA, not just having an emergency use authorization, but has full approval for use in hospitals. Currently, it does not have that outpatient treatment approval, and any use of it outpatient would be an off-label use. But a study called the Pine Tree Trial showed that if you give this to a non-hospitalized patient 3 days in a row by IV, there's an 87% relative risk reduction. So very interesting study, and I do believe many of our hospitals are going to start utilizing remdesivir this way as we have more remdesivir in supply than the other drugs that I've mentioned. So next slide, please. Just wanted to sum up by showing you the stages of COVID illness, starting from prior to showing signs of illness. On the left side, what we have is that ticagivimab, sogavimab combination, the Evusheld, very narrow use, as I said, for just severely immunocompromised folks. And then as you look through the slide, you will see that people who were exposed, they were able to get the Regenpro-V and the Bam-Eddy, although we were prioritizing the use of these monoclonal antibodies for treatment. As you can see below, there is asterisks that say that they are not able to neutralize Omicron. And so what you see is therapy for mild to moderate. Again, you have Bam-Eddy and the Regeneron, but of course falling out of favor in comparison to sotrovimab. And we have the Merck and the Pfizer oral antiviral pills with Paxlovid outperforming molnupiravir. Next slide. And this is my last slide. And really, this shows what each of the current drugs are good for and where they might have some complications. And so we don't really have one perfect drug available at this time. And really, because of the limitations of supply for some of them, I would advise that people do their best not to get COVID in the first place rather than rely on having one of these therapeutics available to them. Interestingly, this chart is in order from left to right as far as preference from the NIH. The NIH has said that nirmatrelvir or Paxlovid is the first preference for use. If you have it, then sotrovimab. Number three, they do recommend the outpatient use of remdesivir, even if off-label. And then lastly, NIH says molnupiravir would be your last choice if you didn't have the others. And the NIH has put out some other outpatient guidelines as well as to how to prioritize when physicians in your county are looking at these allocations, what might you use to prioritize when there's limited supply. And really the first people who are in line are those who are immunocompromised by far. And then we go to people who are perhaps unvaccinated and at risk due to higher age group, and then unvaccinated with lower age group, and then you go on to vaccinated elderly. So there is a tiered system that's put up by the NIH for the use of these drugs. Thank you. And I do believe that my counterpart in EMS can follow up as far as the distribution of these drugs and where they are in this county.
So Dr. Park did a really excellent job in talking about the antiviral medications and what each one can do and not do. So what I want to talk about is availability in the county. So just prior to the beginning of the holidays, CDPH reached out to the medical health operational area coordinators and asked us for basically a game plan on how we wanted to distribute the short supply of antivirals that were going to be allocated to each of the operational areas. What we chose to do is we had some limits on what we could and couldn't do. What the state basically said is we had to utilize existing vaccination, federally approved vaccination providers in order to distribute the antivirals. So that limited the scope of who we could use who we could distribute antiviral medications to. With Dr. Schaefer and others and getting input, we wanted to make sure that we had distribution throughout the community, throughout the entire county, so people would have access to the antivirals. But because it's a prescription 5-day course of treatment, which is a traditional sort of prescription that a physician would write for a patient, rather than sending these to the hospitals, which typically don't do outpatient retail pharmacy, we chose to use the retail pharmacy systems that we currently had in the county. And so what we did is, of the total allocation given to the counties, we allocated 25% of our county allocation to Kaiser in their Kaiser pharmacy network, which is about 20, they have about 25% of the lives in San Joaquin County. So that was an estimate for us on how we would allocate to them. And then we took the other 75% and we allocated it to CVS and Rite Aid. And what you see on the list on the screen is the authorized pharmacies through those pharmacy chains that qualify to receive the antiviral medication. So we have pharmacies in Lodi, Manteca, Stockton, Tracy, and Stockton that are retail pharmacies through CVS or Rite Aid. And then Kaiser, through their pharmacy system, cover Manteca, Tracy, and Stockton through the allocation. So what I do know is, and I highlighted it, the pharmacies that are on Pacific Avenue, the CVS and the Rite Aid, I learned this actually just this morning from a patient, because the state didn't tell us whether or not they actually delivered. So we're not actually taking possession of the medications. The state is drop shipping them directly to the pharmacies. And the state hasn't told us, they said they've been allocated, but hadn't given us confirmation that they'd been received. I just got confirmation this morning that patients were able to pick up their medications from those two pharmacies. We just responded today to the state of California with the next distribution. And we're only, and this is where in my notes, of the monoprevir, we're only getting 480 courses of treatment. That's the one that Dr. Park showed was 33%, about 35% effective. The Pax Lovid, which is more than 85% effective, we're only getting 100 courses of treatment in the next round from the state of California. So a total of 580 courses of treatment. But the one that everybody's going to want, that's the highly effective one, we're only getting 100 courses of treatment. And so those are being distributed evenly across those pharmacies that you see before you in that distribution. I'm going to skip that slide since Dr. Park went over the background of the medications. So the other therapeutics that we're receiving are the monoclonal antibodies. So this is the complete list of everybody who has received monoclonal antibody distribution through the medical health operational area system. Last summer, going into last year, the three big players, or actually we had two big players, San Joaquin County Clinics and Dr. Capre was really the champion for monoclonal antibody infusion in this county. And every chance she gets, she tries to get her colleagues to join her, and she's had a hard time making that sell. Myself, I've been trying to do the same, and so has Dr. Schaefer. I know Dr. Park has as well. So our two big initial sources were actually the county hospital and the clinic system, and CDCR. We got CDCR on board early, working directly with their chief medical officer at the state and getting the monoclonal antibodies into the prison healthcare system. Because if we can keep the prisoners healthy, we can keep them out of the hospitals and takes the pressure off the hospitals. And so we worked really aggressively with CDCR here locally, with California Healthcare Facility, in the early days when we only had the bamlanivimab, and they did their own infusions in-house. They initially were doing them at the hospital. We got them to take that on in-house and do it in-house and prevent those patients from even needing to be coming over to the hospital and impacting San Joaquin General Hospital. And Dr. Capre and her team were very instrumental in helping us do that. The next entity that really came on board was Omnicare of Northern California, which is based in Lodi. They're essentially a specialty pharmacy that provides services to skilled nursing facilities and clinics. They also were very interested in the early days of monoclonal antibody therapy, and we were able to get resources to them. And as the bamlanivimab became more widely available, it became no longer a scarce resource, and pharmacies and hospitals and clinics could just order it. It was only in the last, I think, 6 months, maybe 8 months, that the federal government commandeered it all again and said it has to be allocated to the states. Prior to that, the pharmacies and the hospitals could just order it directly through AmerisourceBergen and have it dropped off like they would any other medication. So each of the hospitals had an allocation of bamlanivimab, and they were using it in their emergency departments on a case-by-case basis based on the provider that was working in the emergency department, the patient that came before them, and whether or not they felt that the patient should be treated. But they didn't start an infusion center where they were soliciting and marketing for outpatient treatment. The only one that was doing that was San Joaquin County Clinics. In the last year, that changed. Sutter Tracy and Sutter Gould Medical Foundation got involved in doing a infusion center in Tracy. And Kaiser Foundation, Kaiser Hospital Manteca, got heavily involved in doing an infusion center. They're originally going to do their Stockton clinic, but my understanding is they've done it all now through the Manteca Center for MAB therapy for their patients. So essentially, those are the only three facilities that are actually recruiting and taking referrals from community physicians for patients who would qualify for MAB therapy. San Joaquin County Clinics, Kaiser for their patients, and then Sutter Gould for their patients as well. Although all the hospitals have an allocation and can now give it to their emergency departments. But there hadn't been a lot of demand in the emergency departments for the Regeneron or the bamlanivimab. What you saw, and what my staff kind of calls the Joe Rogan effect, is people in the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks, are now asking and demanding and wanting the monoclonal antibody therapy, and they're putting pressure on the healthcare system to supply it. So now you're starting to get that supply and demand effect of people seeking it and wanting the medication for a variety of reasons. But now it's out there. So now people are asking us for medication. Unfortunately, because of where we're heading with Omicron, Regeneron and bamlanivimab are no longer as effective, and everybody wants sotrovimab. And so that now is a scarce resource. So the Sotro, so here is last week's, generally the last, I think it was, not every hospital lines up exactly on 7 days, but over the last week and a half or so, what you see here is who's administered monoclonal antibody therapy in the county. No one's given any bamlanivimab, and that essentially, I couldn't give that away if I wanted to. I've been trying. Nobody wants it. It's the physicians don't want the medication. We've been returning all of our allocations that the state gives us almost every week. We can't, nobody wants it. Regeneron, some people were still using, and you can see here, essentially every hospital except Dameron didn't report, but every other hospital who had been receiving an allocation had in the last week been administering both Sotro and Regeneron to patients. And you can see the numbers there. San Joaquin General San Joaquin County Clinics did slightly less than Kaiser. Kaiser was a little bit more aggressive in getting it out. But right now, and my email has been going off pretty regularly in the last couple of days, every pharmacy, every hospital wants the Sotrovimab. Today, we just told the state we're going to distribute 48 courses of treatment they're giving San Joaquin County. So there's nowhere near the supply to meet the demand that our county's going to have right now. And so we just provided that information to the state. There's plenty of Regeneron if somebody wants it. And so that's one of the questions that Dr. Neely brought up. We had a MedMat call yesterday with the hospitals. Dr. Neely, who's the chief medical officer for St. Joseph's Medical Center, I think had a very astute question that we didn't have an answer for. And that is, of the patients that are currently hospitalized that require inpatient therapy, do they have Omicron or Delta? Because if they have Delta and people that are the sickest are getting sickest with Delta, then it makes sense to still use the Regeneron. But we don't know the answer to that question because we don't have the genome sequencing of the patients who are hospitalized, which is something I think that I asked the state CDPH for those numbers. They don't have them. I know Dr. Park is interested, and I think she's going to work with her epi team to see if we can start hunting that down, because that'll, based on the treatments that we have that treat individual variants, very important that we know who are the, what variants making the people the sickest. And the medical community is now asking, I think, some of the really right questions. Now we have to see if public health can provide them the right answers so they can start tailoring their treatments. So that's where that got. The state has now decided that bamlanivimab and Regeneron are no longer short supply. And so they're no longer giving us allocations and limiting how much we can ask for or distribute. So any hospital or infusion center who would like to have any of those, we can supply them essentially all they want. But the Sotro is still in very limited supply. Like I said, we're only getting in the next week 48 courses for the entire county of Sotro. So hospitalizations, we've been tracking since essentially last April, all of the hospitalizations and hospital admissions in the county. So this is all seven hospitals. And you can see we're now in our fourth surge. And what a lot of people have referred to as the north face surge is Omicron, straight up, straight down. Hopefully we follow suit and we have a much shorter period of time. With this particular surge, that's what's been happening, at least in South Africa, where it initially originated and how it's moved across. And hopefully that stays in. I try not to predict what this thing's going to do because I think most of our predictions have been wrong. So I just want to deal with facts. And right now we're heading straight up with hospitalizations. And then you'll see, and this is the 30-day chart, gives you a little bit more granular detail. The red line is ICU admissions. Or ICU COVID patients, and then the gray line is other hospitalizations for COVID. I know, Supervisor Patty, you had a question about who would be ventilated and who wouldn't, and I think that's a great question. In the early days, and you can take the slide down if you want. When the novel virus first appeared in 2020, the medical community had no real good answer on how to treat it. And so they went to what they knew and what we had. We didn't have any therapies. And so everything was supportive care. And because this was a respiratory virus and a respiratory illness that attacks the lungs, the initial treatment, which historically is what you would do to support someone's respiratory care, is to put them on a ventilator, take the burden off the body and help the patient heal. What they realized as they learned more and more about COVID and COVID disease, is that was not a good course of treatment. So we wanted to keep people up. They learned that we don't want to put somebody on a ventilator unless they absolutely have to have it, right? So as a treatment, it was a bad treatment. So they backed off of, the intensivists backed off of utilizing ventilators as a treatment. The next modality that came in was really high flow oxygen. And so, and that was in very limited supply as well, because they're sending basically nasal cannula. And a typical nasal cannula, you'll do, 6 liters per minute if on a pre-hospital call, just to help support. But we're talking really high flow, 30, 40 liters per minute through your nostrils of oxygen. And that requires special equipment that most of the hospitals didn't have. So all the hospitals scrambled. Last year, we were scrambling to get them those resources through the state and others, and so they got that modality, and that became working. Then we started getting our first actual medication treatments. And Remdesivir was one of the very first ones that was available for inpatient only. And you had to, and so it was limited to patients that were in the hospital that were admitted for COVID but weren't on a ventilator yet. So if you weren't on a ventilator but you're heading that way, then the Remdesivir was the treatment of choice. That initially became a very short supply. We were getting just a handful of Remdesivir that we had to distribute to all the hospitals in the county. There was more demand than supply. That went on for probably about 6 months, and then the supply chain opened up, and then it became widely available. So the state no longer distributes that through us. Hospitals can just order that through pharmacies commercially and administer it. So that's the treatment of choice right now for inpatients that require therapy, is you have Remdesivir. Patients with severe disease will still progress to needing a ventilator. They try to do everything they can to keep them off of the ventilator now. And so you'll see their strategies for proning patients, moving them, trying to, you know, work the lungs and work the disease out of the respiratory tract as best you can. It's a lot of hands-on. And it's, so you see a lot of the hospitals have been trying to buy specialty beds to prone patients and move patients. And it's all part of supporting that respiratory care of the patient that needs, who has severe illness in the intensive care unit. But that's kind of really the background that I know of to share with you, and kind of a grand overview of the progression of this, this course of treatment with the hospitals, and kind of why, you know, things have shifted. And you're right, we don't want anybody on a ventilator if we can help it now. That's not a treatment of choice up front, but it still is required for patients that have severe disease and need that ventilatory support, because they're essentially going into respiratory failure.